Houston, contact with a test one.
Touchdown to Kirk.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to a new episode of Space Cowboys.
Hi, everyone, from me, too.
Yes, Herbert. Hi.
Hi, Thijs.
Hi, and with a very special guest today.
Tell me.
Ed Stone from JPL. One of...
Ed Stone.
The big names in interplanetary science, let's call it that. And we're going to talk about the Voyager missions. One of my big
passions.
Both of them. And both of them, yeah.
Good.
For a very long time, I thought there was only one Voyager, but of course, there's not.
And which one was that, one or two?
Well, I think there was always Voyager 1, but there are, of course, two Voyager missions.
Yeah.
And they both left in the summer of 1977.
How old were you back then?
I did not exist. My molecules were spread through the universe.
I knew it.
Yes, yes.
I was 19.
You were 19? Do you vividly remember?
I do.
Yeah?
Yeah. Maybe not so much the launch as the results.
Yeah? The first pictures
so
coming in?
I was so excited by the photographs, mainly of Uranus and Neptune.
Oh, yeah.
Because
of course.
Those were mysteries before.
Just like the only time I ever experienced anything similar was with New Horizons and Pluto.
Yeah.
Which was, for me, it was the feeling of just seeing this little dot, seeing that... becoming a world.
What
to
used
me,
to
there
be
was,
a dot, yeah.
Yeah.
Turned into
very
something.
Very special. Yeah. And the funny thing is, Voyager 2 was launched first, visiting Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Yeah. A couple of weeks later, Voyager 1 was launched, also visiting Jupiter and Saturn, and its moon Titan, of course.
Yep.
And then they went on to venture out towards the edge of our solar system. Now, Now, I wanted to say that they left it, and that's what I always tell people, like, oh, yeah, the Voyager has left the solar system, but they left the heliosphere, of course. Yeah, the bubble around our sun that keeps interstellar particles out.
That's all a matter of definition.
It's a matter of definition.
We'll
to Ed, of course.
Yeah.
Voyager 1 reached interstellar space in 2012, and Voyager 2 has kind of just left our sun bubble last November, and I'm so happy to introduce our guest today. He's the former head of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, currently a professor of physics at Caltech, and of course, the project scientist for the Voyager missions. Ed Stone, welcome to Space Cowboys.
Glad to be with you.
Yeah, wonderful, from California.
Same.
So this show is called Space Cowboys, but I was thinking that maybe that term that you deserve that term a little bit more than we do. You got to watch firsthand what these probes were sending back to us from the far reaches of our solar system. How was it to sort of have that firsthand experience coming back?
It's really been an experience of a lifetime, that's for sure, as we explored and discovered things we had no idea were out there to be discovered. Mm-hmm. So it's been a wonderful journey so far, and we have more to go.
Yeah. How much do you love looking at the data that comes back, even nowadays, not pictures, but just data? How is that for you?
Well, it's telling us what this bubble is like and how big it is. The sun creates a bubble around itself with its million-mile-per-hour solar wind, and we are all inside the bubble. And now we have two spacecraft which have left the bubble and are in the local interstellar space in their billion years of journey now in the galaxy.
Yeah. And just for people who don't understand that bubble, right, can you just take us through it? So how come there's a bubble coming from our sun, and what is that interstellar wind coming towards us?
The sun has an atmosphere, of course, and what was discovered many years ago now is that that atmosphere is speeding away from the sun at 400 kilometers per second, and it's heated by the sun. That's what causes it to expand supersonically, basically, mm-hmm. And that supersonic wind creates a huge plasma bubble surrounding the sun. Until 2012, we didn't know exactly how big the bubble was, and that's when Voyager 1 finally left it and entered interstellar space.
Yeah.
Outside, the wind comes from the explosion of other stars that happened 5, 10, 15 million years ago, and that interstellar wind deforms the bubble into a comet-shaped object. That is, there's a nose and a tail.
And why is that?
Why
is that? Why is it that shape?
It's that shape because the interstellar wind blows the sum of the heliosphere back. Just as in the solar system, you know, a comet will have a long tail because the solar wind does that to the comet. Mm-hmm. And in interstellar space, the interstellar wind does the same thing to the heliosphere.
Oh, yeah.
And can you say in general where this interstellar wind is coming from, or is it coming somehow from all directions?
It's really coming from a particular direction. In fact, if you were looking up at the sky at night and looking toward the galactic center, you'd be looking directly into the wind. The wind isn't coming from the center of the galaxy, of course. It's really local. Mm-hmm. But the direction is that as you would be facing the wind if you look toward the galactic center.
So that's kind of a coincidence.
Yes, it is.
But there's really a direction you could travel in space and have headwind, and another direction where you could travel and have tailwind.
That's exactly right. And the wind was created by these supernova, and they were all together in one side of the sun when they exploded. And so that's where the wind is coming from.
That's great to hear, because it's really new to me.
Yeah. Exactly. And that's what Voyager does, right? It gives you suddenly this vista. Your colleague Nikki Fox, she called this the start of a new era of heliospheric science. And so why did she say that?
This is for the first time we have in situ data. From all we knew about the heliosphere before was observing it from where we are, deep inside the heliosphere, looking out. And so we really now have for the first time two probes actually out where the wind is, measuring the properties of the wind.
Yeah, and of course Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, they're the same machine, right? Are they identical?
They are identical, except one of the instruments is not working on Voyager 1. So we have five instruments working on Voyager 2 and one and four operating on Voyager 1 now.
Mm-hmm. And it's the plasma science experiment, right? That's not working on Voyager 1, but it is on Voyager 2. So
yes,
you're suddenly,
that's correct.
You're getting new data in.
Yes, we are. We're learning more about how the interstellar wind interacts with the solar wind.
Do you have a sneak peek of some of the results? Like, are you already finding stuff out that the world needs to know?
Well, what we have learned, for instance, from Voyager 1 is that there are cosmic rays outside. These are atoms which have been accelerated near the speed of light, and some of them can get in deep inside the heliosphere. But most, in fact, cannot. And we now know that the heliospheric bubble basically serves as a radiation barrier, so that more than 70% of what's outside cannot get in to 1 AU.
70%.
So this is part of our radiation defense.
So that means both Voyagers are getting an even worse bombardment of radiation than they even did. How do they survive? Do you expect them to live shorter because of it?
Well, there will be a radiation effect long term, but it turns out most of the radiation they got was at Jupiter because of Jupiter's immense magnetic field and very intense radiation. Mm-hmm. So that was a very rapid aging process, and the one they're experiencing now is much slower.
Really?
Okay, that's good.
Yeah. I want to sort of rewind to the start of these missions, and also where you were. Where were you? To start off with that, where were you when these missions started?
Well, they really got started in 1965 when a graduate student working at JPL discovered that if you launched a spacecraft in 1977, plus or minus a year, that spacecraft could fly by all four of the giant outer planets. They were all, if you like, sort of lined up so that you could do that.
Yep.
And that's an opportunity that happens only every 176 years. So that was really the start. And that was very early in the space age, and it wasn't clear one could build a spacecraft that could last long enough to get to Neptune.
This was before the moon landing. I mean, this is like early space race.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. And so you started as a graduate student, and during the launch, where were you at that moment?
Well, I was, by the time that I was a graduate student when the space age began, so I was already at Caltech developing instruments for a spacecraft when I was asked to be the chief scientist or project scientist for this new mission. That was 1972. When I became the chief scientist, and I'm still the chief scientist today.
that's a good career.
just to make sure I understand this correctly, this graduate student who discovered the lineup of the planets, was that actually you?
No, it wasn't.
Okay. What was the name of this person?
Gary Flandreau.
Gary Flandreau.
Okay. Did he go on to become a famous astronomer himself as well?
He actually was in aerodynamics and space instrumentation, so he's an engineer.
Okay.
But he was working at JPL looking for these opportunities to fly by other planets and found that you could fly by four of them if you launched in this magical period.
And this was a really once in more than one lifetime discovery, right? So did he get a prize for this or something?
He got a medal.
He got a medal. Okay,
that's good.
That's good enough.
That counts. Yeah. And so, what were the expectations? Because, as you said, you didn't even know if the spacecraft were going to survive. Maybe. What were your expectations when you started this as a scientist?
Well, we expected there would be a lot of discoveries, but we really didn't anticipate how diverse the things in the solar system are. For instance, when Voyager was launched, the only known active volcanoes in the solar system were here on Earth.
Yeah.
Then we flew by a moon of Jupiter, where there's 10 times more volcanic activity than on the Earth. And so suddenly we realized that the solar system was much more diverse than we had imagined. And time after time, we discovered things that we thought we understood, but we really didn't know that they were there.
Was that the first major discovery that it made, those volcanoes?
I would say it was typical of the really dramatic discoveries. The first one. Last one was when we flew by Triton, which is a small moon of Neptune, about the size of Pluto. And it's only about 40 degrees above absolute zero. Even nitrogen is frozen at those temperatures. Yet we've discovered active geysers erupting from the polar caps.
Wow!
How could you imagine that? That's just incredible.
It turned out that our solar system was in a way more alive than we thought it was. Maybe.
That's a very good way of putting it. Yeah. Yes, it's a very dynamic place.
Yeah, nothing but surprises, actually. Right. Yeah. I mean, every moon of Jupiter, Saturn, Neptune, all those ones.
Yeah, I was actually surprised by this picture of Voyager, I think Voyager 1, I'm not sure, leaving Earth and the Moon and even snapping a picture of the Earth and the Moon together. Maybe Pioneer had already done that, but I thought it was kind of cool that Voyager sort of took a last picture of the Earth and the Moon as it was leaving.
That was the first such image where the Earth and the Moon were in the same frame.
Exactly. So that's even where it started, right after it left. Did it get slingshots in any way, like before it went on to Jupiter, or was it just straight there?
It was straight there from Earth.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So how was the Jupiter approach? How did that go? How many years after its launch was that? Do you remember?
Well, that was 1979.
2 years later. Yeah.
2 years later. Pardon me, just a moment.
No worries.
Okay.
Yep. And so tell us about that approach. How did it go?
Well, first of all, we were of course interested in what the Great Red Spot was, and we now know it's a huge hurricane-like storm system. But we also discovered it's just the largest of literally dozens of storms, which are on the order of the size of the Earth. So that atmosphere was much more dynamic than we had imagined, even given the fact we knew it had high-speed winds. Yeah. But that there were lots and lots of vortices, lots of hurricane-like structures in the atmosphere of Jupiter.
Mm-hmm.
That was one. Another big surprise was the moon Europa.
Yeah,
which is the same size as Io, but it doesn't have volcanoes. It has an icy crust, and when we saw it up close, we realized that it looked like an ice pack on a liquid water ocean. Which, in fact, the subsequent Galileo mission really proved that that's the case. There is a liquid water ocean on Europa, and again, when Voyager was launched, the only liquid water oceans we knew of were here on Earth, and here's just a moon, which has such a liquid water ocean beneath its icy crust.
It's crazy.
And you could see already that it has sort of like a young surface. Could you already see it on the Voyager pictures, that it lacked craters and such?
Yes. Voyager showed that we couldn't find any impact craters. We found lots and lots of cracks. We didn't find any mountain ranges or anything like that. It was just like ice on a liquid water ocean.
Oh, yeah. And the pictures being sent back, it was some sort of TV camera almost, right? Can you tell us about the camera? What kind of camera was this?
It's a Vidicon camera, which is a tube It's what that's what used to be used before CCDs were invented. Mm-hmm. And so this was a small tube, maybe about an inch in diameter or so, something of that order, and an 800 by 800 pixel image. So it's a digital image, just like getting your you get images in your digital TV
really?
These days.
A digital,
we
digital
had digital
image?
Images back from Voyager.
What? Really? I didn't even know. No. I thought it was some sort of analog weird signal. Oh, really? So ones and zeros beamed back.
Yes,
through
ones
the
and zero.
Through the deep space network that was already up then?
Yes, that's correct. Uh-huh. Yeah.
And at what data speed did the data come home?
We got at Jupiter, we had a data speed about 115 kilobits per second.
Wow.
By the time we got to Neptune, we had to, where it's much further away and much weaker signal, we had to use all of the deep space network antennas we could, plus the very large array of 27 antennas, plus another 64-meter antenna in Australia to get the data back because it's so far away.
But still 115 kbits.
Yeah,
that was Jupiter.
That's faster than the internet in the 90s.
That's right.
Yes.
That's not that bad for Voyager in the 70s.
Right.
Yep. Well, there you go. This is JPL. NASA, of course, is always, of course, famed for.
You could have beamed video of the really decent quality back then.
Yeah, decent Skype connection from live from Jupiter. Yeah.
Yeah, we could make the first movies, and we did make movies showing these this fascinating system of atmospheric storms.
Of course you did. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah,
but
of course.
That was
beautiful.
Yeah. Putting photographs one after the other, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And so were all the instruments on both Voyagers, were they up by the time they reached Jupiter? Were they still all working or were there any setbacks?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, they were all working.
Mm-hmm.
And we did the first and the only instrument we lost was the plasma, which we lost just at the end of the Saturn encounter.
Oh, really? Okay.
And so, what was the cause of that?
We don't know.
Okay.
It was never determined why. What we knew happened is that the high voltage that you have to have to make the measurement just stopped switching on and off.
Oh, yeah. I just kind of want to know for myself. So Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 are literally 100% identical. There's no difference between the machines themselves.
I think that's correct. There may be some subtle differences, but
not really.
They're all the same instruments. Right, because they were back. The reason we had two was to be sure at least one could, in fact, mission success was at least one spacecraft reaching Saturn.
Yeah.
And returning data on Titan and the rings.
That's right.
And
because
that was mission success. Everything else is a bonus.
One of them was meant to fly past Uranus and Neptune, and it did. And the other one went past Saturn and then went nowhere,
out to the
edge. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, it went toward interstellar space.
That's right.
When we finished the Voyager 2 encounter at Saturn, we knew that the Voyager 1 encounter at Saturn, we knew that we'd done a Saturn science, so we could leave Voyager 2 in the plane of the planets, the ecliptic plane, and head on to Uranus and Neptune, which is what we did.
Yeah.
And that why was it that Voyager 2 that was sent up, right? I sometimes still mix them up. Voyager 1 went on to Neptune and
no, Voyager 1 was flipped.
Went off plane. Yeah.
Up out of the plane of the planets, and there were no more planets that it flew close to, and it just was headed toward interstellar space. That was in 1980 when it flew by Saturn. So from 1980 until 2012 is how long it took for leaving Saturn to get to the interstellar space.
And was that because, I believe I read somewhere that there was an idea to maybe send it on to Pluto, but then it wouldn't be able to see Titan. So that's why it went past Titan, and that's why it went up towards interstellar space. I read that somewhere.
Right. The Saturn's ring plane was inclined, and so that meant that since Titan is in the ring plane, we had to have an inclined orbit. In order to study Titan, and we wanted to do that because we wanted to know what kind of an atmosphere was there, and that was another major discovery.
Yeah,
yeah.
We found that that there's liquid natural gas raining down on the surface of that planet, of that little moon.
It's
a planet-sized moon, by the way. It's almost as big as the planet Mercury.
Yeah, really. I think Carolyn Porco calls it seas of paint thinner. Beaches with paint thinner right on at your feet.
Yeah.
But Ed, tell me, what was actually the design lifetime of both these probes? Did you ever think that they would live this long?
Well, you know, when Voyager was launched, the space age itself was 20 years old.
Yeah.
So there's no way that we could tell how long that anything could last 20 years, since that was just the age of the space age when we were launched.
Let alone twice that.
This is a grand experiment. We did it step by step. Both are still working today, although they do have their limitations. We are running out of power.
Sure.
We have to look carefully at how cold they're getting and so on. That's the new engineering challenge we have. But after all, it's been over 40 years on the journey so far.
Yeah. But what was your intention? What did you say to one another? Okay, if it lives this long, we'll be reasonably happy. What was this long in that case?
Well, mission success was defined that at least one reaching Saturn. So we satisfied that mission success in 1980.
That's very
modest.
Then
we said the next step was we have to have a successful flyby of Uranus. That happened in 1986.
Yeah.
And then we started what we call the Voyager Neptune interstellar mission. And that was 1989 when we did the Neptune part, leaving only now the current mission, which is the Voyager interstellar mission. So this was a stepwise expansion of our objective, not stretching too far each time, just so that we could have a plan for each of these encounters and then what followed on with the interstellar space.
Amazing.
Amazing. So the only reason why certain instruments were shut off at a certain point was only to save energy then.
Once we finished taking all the images, we'd finished flying by all the planets, we turned off all of the planetary instruments, including the imaging system. That saved power, but the amount of power we had at that time was not a problem. We can't save it. It's radioactive decay.
Oh, yeah, of course.
It did mean that we could save space in our computers. The computer memory on Voyager is about 100,000 times less than you have in your smartphone. And so we wanted to use all those memory bits there were for the interstellar mission. So we shut down, reprogrammed the computers to focus on interstellar space rather than on planetary space. And continued, have been running those programs now ever since.
Yeah.
So how, to be precise, how many kilobytes or megabytes do the Voyager probes have?
We have three computers that run the spacecraft. Each of those has about 4,000 words of memory.
4,000 words.
4,000 words, 12-bit words, roughly.
I can't even imagine such a tiny piece of memory.
Yeah, then what do you do with it? Yeah, exactly.
You program every bit very carefully.
Yeah,
I guess
of course,
you do. Yeah, yeah.
Of course, they have plutonium reactors, right? They got
no, not a reactor.
Oh, how do you call it?
Natural radioactive decay of plutonium-238. It just decays away with an 88-year half-life, and when it decays, it gets hot. And so you bolt thermocouples to the heat source and make electricity. It's a very robust, simple, no moving parts, but it does decay away. That's where the energy comes from, is the heat. And so the heat which we use to make electricity means that we have less heat each year to make. We now have to turn off each year something that takes 4 watts, because that's how much we lose, how much less power we have year after year.
4 watts.
And so eventually we'll have to turn off the spacecraft.
Right now it's around 23 watts? Is that how much?
That's the transmitter is 23 watts, but it takes about 70 watts of power to get 23 watts to Earth.
Ah, okay.
So when that does all of this and get to Earth, that's just to transmit 23 watts.
Yeah, so of that 70 watts, you know, a big old light bulb, that's what the entire Voyager runs on. You lose about 4 watts a year right now.
4 watts a year.
Mm-hmm. Whoa. Okay.
And
so
I guess this
it's a countdown.
This decay and the heat
the
decay and the heat it generates also serves to keep the spacecraft itself at a certain temperature, because otherwise it would stop functioning, right?
That's correct. That's the thrusters. We have to keep the thrusters above a few degrees centigrade because that's where the hydrazine fuel freezes. Mm. And so we, as the spacecraft gets colder with time, we have to make sure we find a way to keep the thrusters warm enough so that the hydrazine will continue to be usable.
Okay, you, so you still do attitude control as well?
Oh, yes. The spacecraft always points at Earth. That's the way you get the data.
Yeah, of course.
It's always pointed at the Earth.
But the limiting factor is power from the plutonium source and not the fuel supply.
That's correct. Yeah, we have plenty of fuel. Okay. We just have to make sure we keep the thrusters warm enough and that we have enough power to run everything.
Wow.
Amazing once more.
Amazing once more.
Yeah, beautiful.
So you keep on steering that thing out. How far away are they? 17 light hours-ish?
That's right. Yeah, yeah. That's about right.
Yeah, and they beam back. So you said they beam back their signal with
23 watts. It's a freaking light bulb.
Yeah, it's a light bulb in your fridge-ish.
That's right. No, I don't even get this.
And then 17 light hours away with three antennas, right? One in Australia, one in Spain, and one close to you in California
That's right. We use we're using the largest antennas, which are 70-meter antennas, or we can array two 34-meter antennas. So it takes either one antenna or two 34-meter antennas to collect the data now because it is so faint.
But how faint is it exactly? How much noise is in the background, so to speak?
Well, we still have very good signal to noise. So we're running at 160 bits per second. So the bits are rather long, and that's the way you compensate for the distance. You just stretch out the amount of time it takes to transmit either a zero or a one.
But it's the same speed, if I remember correctly, that that was beamed from Jupiter.
Yeah, and that since there's more power. There's the signal stronger, we can keep the bits shorter. You need to keep the bit on long enough so that you know it's a one and not a zero.
Yeah, yeah.
And the further away you get, the longer you have to wait before you transmit another bit, if you like.
Yeah.
So we can transmit about 160 bits per second now.
160 bits per second. Yeah.
Oh, bits. Yeah,
yeah. Not kilo. Not kilobits.
Okay.
No.
Right. Yeah. Okay. It's a factor of thousands.
Yeah, a factor of thousands.
I missed that.
Yeah.
I missed.
Exactly.
Okay. I apologize.
Yeah. And so it comes in the form of a wave, I guess, like a radio signal, and but it also becomes almost like Morse code in this way if it's only 160 bits.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Interesting. So at a certain point, it goes out of beyond Neptune. And Voyager 1 goes up, right?
Yep.
And takes this family portrait, of course, of the entire solar system. Can you take us back to that moment? Why the family portrait?
Well, we realized this was the first opportunity where we had a camera beyond all the planets. So when this was actually on Voyager 1, it was in February 14th of 1990. That we took the photograph, a series actually of images, because the whole planetary system won't fit on one frame. So we had a whole set of frames so that when we, pasted them together, they would show the planets just arrayed in the solar system. The first time that we could do that. And so we thought that was another milestone in human exploration.
Yeah. Was that actually Carl Sagan's idea, or is that just urban, or is it?
Well, he was certainly an important factor in making it happen, because it meant we had to continue the mission operations for another year to do it,
and so keep all the instruments
on. Of funding that was required, as well as keeping the staff on board, so we could take one last set of images, process them, and so on.
Really,
and
for
that's
those
what
pictures,
we did the first 6 months of 1990.
Really, so only for specifically for those pictures.
Those are some expensive pictures.
Yeah, but really cool pictures.
Oh yeah,
not just any pictures.
Worth every dollar.
Yeah, and of course the pale blue dot was in there.
Yes.
Yeah, and. How did that come to be? Because there's this weird light coming from the side.
That's a scattered light. That's
what is that?
Well, it's just scattered light. That, you know, the camera was never designed to look that close to the sun, and so what happens is you get a glare, if you like.
Okay, so it's sunlight, right?
It was in the light in the beam is from the sun. It's just scattered into that stream.
Yeah,
it just happened to capture the Earth as in that beam as an accident again.
But I do think we ought to explain. Maybe some listeners don't know the pale blue dot.
Yeah,
Carl Sagan had the idea to have Voyager look back to Earth.
Yeah, the whole solar system. So it's a whole.
Well, that's not the pale blue dot.
Yeah, the pale blue dot was. So they took a picture of Earth. If I'm making any mistake, then please correct me.
Yeah.
But so then they took a picture of Earth, and Earth in the family portrait is the pale blue dot. Right?
Is that
that's
so?
Correct.
Yeah, okay. That's correct.
Okay. I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah.
I learned another thing.
Yeah, okay. We learned a lot today.
So we took separate images. There was an image that had Jupiter in it. Then we had to turn the camera a bit and take a picture with Saturn in it. And then we would move it a bit and take a picture of it with each of the planets.
Okay.
The only one, as I recall, we couldn't do that was we couldn't do Mars. Because I think it was too close to the sun, and we couldn't do Mercury because it was too close to the sun.
Okay, so it was sort of a panoramic picture.
Yeah.
It's a panoramic picture.
Moving the camera gluing it together.
But so the family portrait doesn't include Mercury and Mars. They've been expelled from the family. The black sheep of the family. I never knew. I never knew they weren't in there. Is it constantly coding the Voyagers, or is there some sort of old interface there at JPL that people still push like the same old buttons? How does it look like? How do you control those two spacecraft?
Well, we can control by sending commands to the spacecraft and changing the program on the spacecraft to do something different than it had been planned to do. And so we occasionally, a few times a year, will send up a new set of instructions to do something a little bit differently or to do something that hadn't been done before, for instance. So we can do that. We send up commands, digital commands, mm-hmm. ones and zeros again,
okay.
and change the program in the spacecraft so that when the time comes, it does something different.
Sure. But what I'd like to know, and this may be a very stupid question, do you still use at Mission Control the stuff that you used back then, or has this all been updated hardware-wise?
All the ground-based hardware has been upgraded. In fact, we had one computer which was completely out of date that we kept on through Neptune. That was one which had to do with sequencing of things, and we didn't want to have to qualify the program on a new computer, so we managed to keep that ancient computer running until we finished all the imaging. And then we shut it off, and there are no programs left anywhere display those, to interpret those bits and zeros that make images.
Yeah, because I figure it can be harder to use modern equipment to control an ancient piece of hardware like Voyager, in some cases, than to use the ancient stuff.
Well, no, that's actually turns out that all we need to do to actually control it is to send up commands which change the 4,000 some part of the 4,000 words of memory, and it's actually easier to do that with modern equipment to send it up because you're just changing the computer, which is a very tiny computer compared to our capability on Earth.
And you need to edit some commands, and you can do that on any computer because it's basically all just text.
That's right. It's all just ones and zeros.
Yeah.
Just sending just plain old ASCII text up or something. It's computer code.
Or machine language or whatever.
Language. Yeah.
It's probably machine language, right?
Machine language. Yeah, very cool. I sort of want to look ahead to the future. So you already said that both Voyagers are now in what's the name of the mission? The heliospheric mission?
The Voyager Interstellar Mission.
So that's the currently active mission.
I would like to take a step back, if you don't mind.
Okay, then we'll talk about the future in a second.
Because we have, when we started this podcast, I said something like, it's all a matter of definition. And I'd like to run through the definitions. We have the solar system, we have the heliosphere.
Good.
We have stuff like the Kuiper Belt and the Oort Cloud. I'd like to know, when I was a kid, I learned about the planets, and there was Pluto was the last one, and beyond Pluto, there was nothing. Nothing.
Yeah, that's how
that
I was taught
worth,
as well.
Worth
yeah.
knowing. I mean, yeah. So to me, the solar system ends with Pluto. That's all, you know. So nowadays it's different. But Ed, can you tell me if we move beyond Pluto, what boundary do we get first, like the heliosphere or the Oort cloud? Or tell me what's yeah. the order of things,
yeah,
please.
Great. Good question.
Well, the first thing, the first boundary that you cross, and it's really the only clear boundary, is the heliopause itself. This is where the solar wind and the interstellar wind meet.
Okay.
And that's a very clear boundary. And beyond that, there, what's beyond that is the Kuiper Belt, which extends. See, the heliopause is actually the Kuiper Belt is actually much of it is inside the heliosphere.
Mm-hmm.
The Kuiper Belt is inside the heliosphere.
That's
okay.
right,
yeah. And that's
right.
where comets live. Okay.
Yeah, and then yeah. the comets that the long period comets come from the Oort cloud, and it will take us about 300 years to get to the inner edge of the Oort cloud.
You
and
mean
it takes us about 30,000 years to get to the outer edge of the Oort cloud?
That's flight time of Voyager, is that right?
I'm sorry?
You say 300 years, that's flight time of Voyager.
Yes, that's Voyager,
right?
How long it'll be for Voyager.
Okay, yeah.
That's too bad because, well, it won't. They won't last that long.
You won't see that. No.
But 300 to 30,000 years. That's so the Oort cloud is gigantic.
Huge.
Yes.
Gigantic.
Well, you see, the Oort cloud is just comets which are in orbit about the sun. But when you get, if you think of it, if you get as close to another star as you are to the sun, you're right between them. Mm-hmm. At that point, those comets are going to be around either planet. But as you continue on, the comets will be around that next star.
Yeah,
because that gravity field will be stronger.
So both stars, Oort clouds meet; they kiss, so to speak.
Yeah.
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 Okay.
And so there's hardly anything between Pluto and the heliopause, and the heliopause being the edge of the
well,
heliosphere.
Well, the Kuiper Belt is in that region between Pluto and the heliopause.
Okay.
So, and where, in your opinion, does the solar system end?
Well, the solar system. It doesn't have a clear end. There's a balance point somewhere between the sun and the nearest star, halfway between, roughly halfway, depends on what the masses are of the two stars. So there's a gradual transition where eventually you're orbiting the other star. You're closer to the other star than you are to the sun.
Yeah, yeah. So you would, if I interpret this correctly, you would define each star's territory, each star's solar system as the edge of its Oort cloud.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, yeah.
yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So all these solar systems actually also kiss.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing is, Ed, I have a tattoo of Voyager. Because I love your project very much, and in bars I always keep on telling people like, oh yeah, it's the only man-made object that left the solar system.
Actually, Ed, we should send you a photo. Maybe we will.
Yeah, right? I'll send you a picture of it, and it's nicely done. Like I really love the artist who made it.
I can testify that.
Yeah, but I always keep on telling this wrong in bars. Then I guess like I keep on saying like, oh yeah, it left the solar system, but. I have to change my story.
30,000 years, Thijs.
Yeah, yeah. The reason I got it though is because it's this. It keeps on exploring. It keeps on finding new things. So I thought that was very, very inspiring. So that's why that story still holds, right?
Yeah, that's wonderful.
But I wonder how we'll talk about it in 10 years, because we're not really sure if we still get data in about 10 years from Voyager, right?
That's right. That's right.
What? How do you see it? Well, how will the next 10 years or 20 years go?
Well, we will still have lots to learn about this interaction between the interstellar wind and the solar wind, and we will do what we can for the next 5 to 10 years to take best advantage of this unique opportunity. It'll be decades before another spacecraft is where the Voyagers are today.
Mm-hmm.
True.
Which instruments are still on?
On Voyager 2, we have a plasma instrument measuring the wind. We have a plasma wave instrument, which measures the oscillations in that wind. We have a low-energy charged particle instrument, which measures things that have been accelerated up to, say, 5% the speed of light. Then we have the Cosgrave instrument, which measures the particles which have gotten accelerated up to almost the speed of light, called cosmic rays coming from those supernova explosion, and we have the plasma instrument, which measures the wind.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
On Voyager. That's on Voyager 2, not on Voyager 1.
And so then how will you determine?
On the magnetic field, yes. We have a magnetic, we also measure the magnetic field.
Okay. Yep.
Inside the bubble, the magnetic field came from the sun. Outside, the magnetic field is from the galaxy.
Right.
Insane.
Is there any to speak of?
Yeah. I'm sorry?
Is there any magnetic field to speak of?
Oh, yes. Yes,
yes, it's significant.
The field outside in the interstellar space is a bit stronger than the field inside our bubble.
What? How?
Okay.
Well, the field inside our bubble comes from the sun. It's a long way out there. So the field gets very weak.
And then the galaxy is bigger.
The galaxy is bigger, and the field is actually a bit stronger.
Oh.
Crazy.
But aren't they in some sort of balance right at that point? Right
well,
now?
Yeah, there is a balance. And the point is, it's not the magnetic field which balances. It's the total pressure, which includes the wind itself, the plasma.
Man.
So there's pressure from the plasma, just the wind pressure, and there's pressure from the magnetic field.
Mm-hmm. Which is the first instrument you have to start shutting off, you think?
We haven't decided that yet, but we have three instruments which have heaters. The first thing we'll be turning off are the heaters, and we'll turn off a heater that will give us an additional year. Then we turn off the next heater that gives us another year, and the third heater we turn off gives us another year. And then we have to start turning off one of the instruments, four watts each.
Is that a sad thing to do for you?
Well, it's been a great journey. It's been quite a joy.
But still,
sure, I'm sure. Yeah.
Do you have any guidance on what are the rules of which ones you want to shut off?
Well, that really depends on what the situation looks like in terms of instrument health. At the time we have to do this, and also the question of what science is remaining that can be where if we have to prioritize the science. And mm-hmm. So the two energetic particle instruments, we would shut off one of those in order to, because we have only one. I think that's will be one of the first things we'll turn off is one of the charged particle instruments.
Okay, and so that which is the one that you want to keep on for the longest as possible?
Well, that will really depend on what's
except
working
the transmitter,
and what science is telling us.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
This is all exploration, so we will make best use of make the best decisions we can at the time we have to make them.
Yeah, yeah. Great. You know what we haven't talked about yet? And it's kind of funny because everybody always talks about it right away. It's the Golden Record. The Golden Record. How long? So the Golden Record, for the people who don't know, but I assume that our listeners kind of know. A golden.
Otherwise, Google it.
No, otherwise, Google it. On YouTube, you can listen to all the sounds. You can see all the pictures.
That's right.
A plate, of course, with almost like a time capsule of humanity in the 70s. I love the picture of the children holding their hand on the Earth. It's such a. I don't know. Do you know who came up with these pictures?
Yes, I'm not sure exactly who came up with which picture, but there's a book out called Murmurs of Earth, which Carl Sagan and the team wrote about how they chose what music is on the record, what pictures are on the record, what greetings are on the record.
Yeah.
You know
so
what I
good.
Love? I love mm-hmm. the idea that all those pictures were analogically coded.
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't that right, Ed?
I'm sorry, say that again.
The pictures are coded in an analog signal.
Yes, that's correct. This is a grooved record, and so it's encoded. It's not coded. It's just a record like the old-fashioned grooved music records. But instead of making music with the groove, you make the sweep of the electron beam on a cathode ray tube, like the old-fashioned televisions did.
And that's a crazy idea to me. And somehow the recipe for decoding it is also on the record, right?
Yes, that's right. That's yep.
And there's a video, I think, either by Motherboard or The Verge from a few months ago, I think two, 3 months ago, where they try to decode As if they're aliens. Like, is this actually something?
Can
that
this
we can,
be done?
Yeah, of course. There's a lot of sort of like things that you have to keep in mind, and it has to do with, especially the timing is really hard to get right. I believe, right? But so, how long will these records last?
Once you see, when you look at what's called the golden record, is actually a dust cover. The record, grooved record itself, is behind the dust cover to protect it. The estimates are that that dust cover should last at least a billion years in terms of preventing dust from obliterating the grooves in the record. Uh-huh. And the record is two-sided, so the backside of the record will last much, much longer.
Whoa. It will just keep on going around the center of the Milky Way.
Yes.
Just like us. Like,
yep.
Endlessly until so it will outlive the sun then, if it's a billion years or ish.
Yes, not quite.
The sun will still be there, but our Earth will probably not be habitable by then.
That's
that's right.
We'll see about that. But
you now can foresee when the last instrument of Voyager will be turned off, right?
Yes.
That's in about 4 years. Did I get that?
No, in about 2026. Ed, is that around
something like that? That's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Summer,
okay.
That's
about
when
7 years.
Dropping in. Yeah.
Okay. So, what will you do next?
What's your new career going to be, Ed?
We've already started on that. We have an instrument on the Parker Solar Probe, which was launched last August, and had one solar flyby. Mm-hmm. And has 24 flybys of the sun at each in a stepwise fashion, getting closer and closer to the sun to explore where all the wind began that created the heliosphere, if you like.
Yeah, great.
So you're looking the other way now.
Yeah, you're looking the other way.
This is the inner frontier. This is the inner frontier of the heliosphere.
Yeah.
It's super. So suddenly you're doing heliospheric science. Like that was something that you sort of got into. Because of Voyager, then.
I'm sorry? What's the question?
So suddenly you do heliospheric science, even though Voyager was just Voyager was a quest for exploration to see what's out there, and then it turned into a very legit new form of science of studying the heliosphere.
That's correct. Yes.
Yeah.
So now we're studying the inner frontier of that heliosphere.
Yeah, perfect.
Near the sun, within 10 solar radii in its last encounters.
It's very, very close.
Yeah. Very close, yes.
Yeah.
Hasn't burned up yet, the Parker Solar Probe. No. We talked earlier on this show about maybe missions to Neptune and Uranus.
Hang on about this.
Oh, sorry.
Just one
Herbert,
more question about Parker and Voyager. How does this work for you time-wise? How much of your time does one take up and how much the other?
Well, it varies. Whether we have an event or whether, in other words, when we cross the heliopause, that's clearly an event.
Mm-hmm.
And so that takes more time. But then during the regular steady cruise, it takes less time. So it varies. And the Parker Solar Probe, of course, every few hundred days there's another encounter with the sun, so it's a rather different pace.
Sure.
But the data can come back only at certain times when the spacecraft and the antennas are proper. So it's a somewhat different planning that goes on with the solar probe. Very dynamic because there's it changes every 200 days.
Yeah, so they both have their own rhythm, so to speak.
Yes.
Yeah, Voyager being, every 5 years, of course, I guess,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
and some events along the way.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so maybe a mission to Uranus or Neptune to go check out for a second time what's there. How do you feel about that?
Well, there will be another. There's every 10 years there's a survey that the National Academy of Sciences runs with the community to determine what the next steps are. And there are always lots of good ideas about what to do next. And the next decadal survey will get started in a few years. And right now, the next step in the outer planets is a mission to Europa.
Mm. Of course.
Beautiful.
To try to fly by very close to Europa and really determine what this world is like, and whether there are any places where their liquid water is coming to the surface and could might be or some other way analyze what that ocean might be like beneath its icy crust.
Mm. Wouldn't you love for a probe to land there?
Oh, eventually, but the radiation environment at Europa is incredibly intense.
All right.
And so you'd want to bury something, and you'd like to find a place where you don't have to bury it too deeply. So the main thing right now is the next mission will be one of mapping. That is of looking looking on the surface where there's current activity of any sort. I mean, there are some indications there may have been some plumes at one point in some of the data we have. And so I think that Europa mission is going to be a very important one.
Okay.
And not Enceladus instead of Europa.
Well, Europa sort of got in the head of the pack and the priorities because we've been studying Europa now since Voyager and the Galileo mission proved that there's a liquid water ocean. So it really became the next priority. But I think eventually there will be missions to Enceladus, there'll be missions to Titan.
Yeah.
There are obviously going to be more missions to Mars. This whole issue of search for life is, I think, a very powerful one.
Yeah, because Enceladus, of course, Cassini already flew through the plume. So we have already found organic material, even, I think, in that plume.
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna see. We're gonna see. And so no.
I hope so.
So you're not rooting for anyone for a mission to Uranus or Neptune.
No, I'm not. I'm going to let the community. I'll just watch the community decide what they want.
You've already been there. Exactly.
Does it feel that way? By the way, do you feel as though you've been there?
Well, certainly, you feel like you've been there. You're seeing things that nobody's seen before.
Yeah.
And that's certainly the case for Mars, where you're actually seeing it down on the surface, just as though you were standing there.
That's right. It's incredible, right? Yeah.
Incredible. Well, thank you for talking to us, but also thank you for being on that mission. It's an inspiration, I think, for the whole world. So,
absolutely.
Yeah. So thank you very much.
It's been great talking with you.
Yeah, and, the same.
Same.
And good luck with all the new endeavors and your study of the inner heliosphere as well.
Right.
All right. Thank you so much, Ed.
Thanks, Ed. Bye-bye.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Bye-bye. And thanks to all our listeners.
Yeah,
as well.
All of them.
Yes, for staying tuned. You can listen to the show on Spotify, on iTunes, or anywhere where podcasts live. But also don't forget to subscribe on YouTube, because
and
there's also video, of course.
Via Patreon.
And you can support the show,
patreon.com/spacecowboys.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.
Touchdown to Crumbs.